Hello, this is Matt Slick from the Matt Slick Live podcast, where I defend the Christian faith and lay out our foundations of the truth of God's Word. Your chosen Truth Network podcast is starting in just a few seconds. Enjoy it, share it, but most of all, thank you for listening and for choosing the Truth Podcast Network.
This is the Truth Network.
As I hear tell, all the parts are crammed into one big part.
Fused.
Yeah, then the one big part is cut up into little pieces parts. And parts is parts.
Well, it's a 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59 automobile.
Welcome to the Christian Car Guy Radio Show.
I say this calls for action, and now.
Now, my class, you will learn to think for yourselves again. You will learn to savor words and language.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and all your soul and all your mind. And love all of mankind as you would love yourself. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul and mind, and love all mankind.
Well, it's a 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59 automobile.
Aristotle's check engine light today on the Christian Car Guy Show. Yes. That seems a bit mystic. I like it. So Aristotle's check engine light. So the real question is, what sets off your check engine light? If it's cars, quite often the oxygen sensor. But for you personally, like, you know that something's not quite right here. Maybe you're angry or you're sad or there's some unbelievable crying that you're going through and you know that something has gotten to you. You really don't understand it. And so it's time to look under the hood. And so, along that idea, Aristotle, he's got some wisdom for us that we're going to get to here in a bit. But right before we do all that, I just want to ask you, how do you know that it's time to check with God? Like, man, I need to be in prayer right this second. Something is just not what it ought to be. So we want you to call us with that story, 866-348-7884, 866-348-7884. So our mission, if we choose to accept it today, is to make Aristotle and the Bible extremely practical. Like, how can we use this information to really improve our relationship with God and thus improve our lives? So you may have heard, right? Parts is parts. I love that. But at the very beginning, that was from the famous Wendy's 1984 ad, right? If you heard that, that's where that's
the chicken nugget.
Right, there you go. Parts is parts. And then Johnny Cash's One Piece at a Time, right? That famous. And by the way, if you go to ChristianCarGuy.com, I got that picture of that car that Johnny Cash was sitting on that had been put together with all those parts. I don't know who made it, but it was pretty cool. And then you heard Robin Williams in Dead Poets Society. And listen carefully what he said. You will learn to savor words and language. And so we're going to hopefully learn a little bit of that. And then we do that for a reason, because, again, we're trying to get closer to God, improve our lives, and also improve our cars. So we'll get to all the above in today's show. And then there was Demi Dad Infinity with that song of loving God, which you might have recognized that from maybe Deuteronomy 6 or, Matthew 12, all those places where it says love the Lord your God. And listen to the parts involved in that, okay? If you're wondering where the connection is, Bob, here you go. There's parts involved. All your heart, all your soul. And then there's this strange word at the end that we're going to spend some time on. So today's show is always brought to you by Hebrew Word. I'm sure you knew that, Bob.
Hebrew letter.
Yeah, it's a letter, but it's also a word.
Oh, there we go. I've learned something else.
So the word / letter is the first letter in the Hebrew alphabet. It's Aleph. It matches up real good with our A. And so when you hear alphabet, it's not unlike the fact that that's an Aleph that begins it. And that Aleph, if you look closely and you do a study of the word family, or you look at family, like the first letter in the word dad is an Aleph. The first letter in the word mom is an Aleph. The first letter in the word sister? You guessed it. Aleph. The first letter in the word brother? Ah, it's Aleph. And it's also the first letter in the word Adam. And it's also the first letter in the word Abraham. So we're going to get into all that magic there shortly. But, you know, before we get to Aristotle's famous quote, which you may know that his quote, a lot of people would quote him as saying that this that the whole is greater than the sum of its parts, which is a little misquote, but we'll spend some time. So it all fits together with parts, Bob. And I don't know if you knew this, Bob, but my original position when I went to work in a car dealership was in the parts department. And so parts has always been a big thing for me. And you sent, as I recall, 109 U Pullet was a parts place.
Absolutely. See, parts has been a big part of my life also.
All right. So think about it. Right, the whole thing is greater than the sum of its parts, and the idea being there that, you know, if you had all the parts of a car sitting there in a heap, you know, it wouldn't be quite as cool as having the whole car. But there's lots to think about in that whole thing. But I want to illustrate all this to begin with a story. So I've told this story many times. It's one of my favorite stories. And I took my granddaughter fishing in Colorado when she was 8 years old. And I had been the only person to take her fishing prior to us going to Colorado. So I was hoping for a better experience when we got there because she had not quite, even though she was 8, she hadn't perfected the idea of patience, Bob. And
at 65, I still struggle, Brady.
Yeah, so every time she would throw her, cast her line in the water, which she could do that, but as soon as the bait hit the water, she pretty much said, I got one, and started to reel it in, even though, you know, there never was one on there. And this went on for like a day and a half. And then, you know, between all the snags that she would get and fixing her rod and reel, and she had her mom with her, which is my daughter, Tess. And of course, this is my granddaughter, Lila, I'm talking about. And so I was getting more and more and more frustrated because we weren't catching any fish, obviously, due to the fact that we weren't leaving the bait in the water long enough. And, you know, there's just this constant fixing of lines, which is frustrating when you were hoping to catch fish, right, Bob?
Absolutely. tackle box adventures can be challenging, and when you break your stuff and you're having to dig in the box and hoping there's another piece that you need in there.
All right. So in this case, Lila was my check engine light, because after some time, I got extremely frustrated. Really, and at one point I just stopped her and I said, you know, Lila, you, and I said it rather harshly, I'm sure, probably very harshly, Lila, you have got to leave your bait in the water long enough for the fish to find it. And she says, Papa, you have violated the first rule of fishing. I'll never forget that as long as I live. She was my check engine light.
There you go.
And of course, immediately I thought, well, wait a minute, I taught her how to fish. What in the world is the first rule of fishing? And she said, have fun. And I went, oh my goodness, you are so right. You are so right. The first rule of fishing.
Having fun reeling it in quick. That's what she's supposed to do.
So I said, well, Lila, why don't we just pray for a minute, which is the best thing to do when you realize your check engine light is going off. And I said, let's just pray. I'm going to pray that you'll have more patience, and I'm going to pray that I have more patience with you. And while we're at it, why don't we ask God if you can maybe catch a fish or two? And so we stood on the bank of that river there in Colorado that day and prayed, and I'll never ever forget it as long as I live. It was a neat prayer. But what happened next?
You have to be careful praying for patience.
So what happened next was, right, she casts, and at that moment in time, out of the corner of my eye, I see my daughter down the river, and she's swinging her pole back and forth like she's snagged. So I start to head that direction. I get about 3 feet away when I hear this, got one. I turned around expecting to see what I'd seen so many times before. But in this case, Lila had a fish. And man, and she was like, I got you, you little dickens. And she was going all over the river. It was a beautiful trout. And she proceeded to catch many more. Now, I love that story. And it taught me a lot that day about what to do when your check engine light starts flashing. But what I did not understand is that the word Messiah in Hebrew has the same letters in it as the word joy. And so the word Messiah, as you may know, has to do with anointing. Well, you may know the joy of the Lord is your strength and all those things. And I know in your presence is fullness of joy. I understood all that, but I did not realize that part of your anointing, in other words, what you're missing if you don't have joy, right? The reason your check engine light's flashing, Robby, you clearly didn't have joy, is you're saying you need to be patient, right? What I'm missing is that anointing of joy. And you don't get that without asking. Like, it comes from him. It's not something you have inherently. I mean, as much as I would like to know that. So when we come back, I would love to know what trips your check engine light. How do you know, wow, I need to pray right this second because things are not clearly where they need to be. 866-348-7884, 866-34-TRUTH. When we come back, we'd love to hear your story. And Bob has a story for you, and it may be along those lines. He'll be right back.
You're listening to the Truth Network and TruthNetwork.com.
You will learn to savor words and language.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. And love all of mankind as you would love yourself. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul and mind, and love all mankind.
Well, it's 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59.
Aristotle's check engine light today on the Christian Car Guys show. Aristotle's check engine light. So what in your life is flashing at you that tells you, boy, it's time to check in with God. Like, I need a father right this minute. I need some more input, right? However that may work in your life, whether it's anger or joy or maybe sadness. Like, you're listening to a song and the next thing you know, man, you're just tears are flowing. And it's time to check in. Like, God may be trying to reach out and touch you.
Kind of like last month at the fair.
Right.
Yeah. Well, I really got my bell rung that day. We were out there, and I knew things weren't, you know, perfect in my life, but things were pretty good. And we got a phone call, and it was a friend of mine from the past that I'd known for years and years. His name's Mike Dillon, and he was calling to tell everybody about the men's gathering that they were having at Richard Childress Racing, and it was coming up, and it was just like, boom, it hit me just so, this is exactly what I need. Bob, you need to make sure. I said, God had him call in. While you were on the radio, you got to talk to him. It rung your bell. Now follow through and go. And I went by myself that night, and it was about spending your first hour of the day with God. 30 minutes of prayer and 30 minutes of reading the Bible. And two things that both of those were lacking in my life at that time. And it was something I really needed a little boost. And the meeting that night was just incredible. Robby asked me, he says, so, well, who was there? I said, 700 of my closest friends. They had a very, very successful evening, and it touched me. And if it touched others in the same fashion it touched me, then it was a very, very, very awesome thing to be a part of. And I am so grateful to Mike for calling in and, you know, ringing my bell that day.
And so that's all the more reason that you should call, right? Because you don't know whose bell, like, God is pulling on your shirt right now. Like, you know you need to call. You know that the check engine light went off the other day and I needed to check in with God. You know that that might ring somebody's bell that God's trying to get up with them. So you got to ring our bell, 866, the number to call, 866-348-7884, 866-34-TRUTH. So I know, Bob, you're wondering what in the heck is all this about Aristotle? Well, it's actually quite helpful. It really is. And I think I'm going to hopefully get this to where it's practical for you. So you may know that a lot of people would quote Aristotle as saying the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. But actually, that isn't what he said. So it is helpful to me to know that isn't what he says, because that sounds sort of like there's a math equation going on, because, you know, the sum of the parts. And of course, you know, Aristotle was not a mathematician. He was a philosopher, okay? And so actually when he wrote this, which happens to be in Aristotle's Metaphysics book, actually chapter 8, he was actually speaking about the definition of words. So, thus you get the idea of what Robin Williams was saying. You'd learn to savor words and language. And as you read the Bible in that half an hour in the morning, which is critical, I can't tell you how critical that is to my life, that's a lot more than an hour anymore. But nonetheless, I can't speak highly enough about that idea. But, you know, clearly you will learn that one word can turn a whole thing around, right? And so what he actually said, and again, if you know, I have the whole quote there at christiancarguy.com if you want to look, but what he said was, in the case of all things which have several parts, in which the totality is not as it were a mere heap, but the whole is something besides the parts. Okay. So if I were to pile up everything that makes up Bob Young right this minute, you'd have some potassium and you'd have some sodium and you'd have some water. And you could say that the sum of all that is Bob Young. And that seems greater than, but wait a minute, salt and light. Like, I don't know that, you can make that determination if it's greater, but it's clearly something besides the parts, right?
Other than.
Right. Other than. And so what am I getting at? Well, here's how that connects back to the idea of the first rule of fishing, because the word joy is the same letters rearranged of the word Mashiach. It's the idea of, if you hear Simsha, you can hear the same letters in joy as you would hear in Mashiach, which is Messiah. But the word that I was actually studying is the word at the end of love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul. And then it says, most translations say all your strength or all your might. Well, the word in Hebrew is the word meod, but that is another way of using the same letters that spell the word Adam. Now, Adam means a human being in Hebrew. Okay, so Adam and people, it's same thing. But those letters make up the idea of what you're supposed to love God with. Now, what is that in telling you? That the same parts that made up Adam, which is dirt, we should have called him Dusty, right? I don't know why they called him Adam, but I would have called him Dusty, Bob. I'm just saying. It just makes way more sense. But anyway, his name means dirt, and it really does. But if you take those same letters and put the mem on the other end of it, actually, then you end up with the word meod, which means all your everything. And so my question to you is, as you think about all your everything, like you're supposed to love God with all your everything, have you ever been so upset at somebody that something awakened in you that scared you? Like, I didn't know I had that much power, like that superhuman strength that people talk about, like whatever pumped. Have you ever thought about that? All that you put together and all that focus of whatever it was you had in that situation is what God wants you to love him with.
Ooh.
You see what I'm saying? Ooh. Like, that's meod. That's what that is. And you don't get it unless you begin to get Aristotle's picture. So we will be back with more on Aristotle's check engine light. But I need your calls, man. You got to call me.
This is the Truth Network.
You will learn to savor words and language.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. And love all of mankind as you would love yourself. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul and mind, and love all mankind.
Will it support a 50-51-52-53?
Aristotle. Check engine light today on the Christian Car Guy Show. And the idea of Aristotle's check engine light is actually quoting his concept that, right, the totality is not a mere heap, but the whole is something beside the parts. And we were talking about right before that if you take the parts of what, you know, the second part of the Shema, or the, you know, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength or mind, as they say right here, as they said in that song, that last little tidbit right there in Hebrew is the letter miod, is the word miod. And that word is made up of the letters that make up the idea of mankind itself. And it normally is like, it could be translated very or excessively, but what it really, it, to me, is I've been thinking about what it feels like, if I could get that taste in my mouth for a minute, is if you ever been so mad that you could just tell that it released whatever superhuman strength, like you were totally focused on whatever it was, you had focus on nothing other than that, and you were completely engaged in that, and actually you became so engaged, it scared you of the power that you had. That's the word. Like, Bob, you know what I'm talking about? Like, I can remember several stories where I had that kind of power at my disposal, and I was supposed to be channeling that towards loving God.
I haven't had a super angry moment. Now, I've had some super joy moments, and I think it, maybe not to the same extent, but it releases stuff in you that changes you and changes your emotion and changes your whole metabolism. I mean, it can just really.
Oh, yours may be way better than mine, right? It's what, but the idea is, all of a sudden, your focus is totally off of
anything else,
right?
You know,
it's just, everything you got.
Yeah. The recent adventure when I happened to get the fish of the year this year, I was crazy. I mean, I'm so afraid it's going to get away, but I'm so thrilled that the line is peeling off of my reel, and I become a different person. I lack regard for anyone's feelings around me. The main thing is focus on getting that fish to the beach and getting it out so we can claim it as a fish, because, you know, if it don't come out of the water, you didn't catch a fish.
Which, it's interesting that we're back to fishing here, as we had talked about that idea before of the first rule of fishing. But, you know, here in this year, really, God's had me on this plan. Like, Robby, I want you at the point where that happens, where the line is ripping off the reel, and you know you got the big one. At that moment, I want to reel that fish in with you, right? And so I told my, you know, I'd been on this steelhead fishing trip up north, and you've seen the pictures of that. And
ooh, yes, I was very jealous of your fishing trip.
And me of yours. But anyway, and so I was just like, man, guys, you got to help me, because what I want to do is I want to catch one of those steelhead on a fly rod, and I want to enjoy reeling it back in while I am experiencing God at the same time, right? I want that experience. And every time that the fish would hit, I got that feeling that, you know, like, all you can think about, you're so excited to get into the fish. And so one of my buddies, Terry, you know, he heard me talk about that. So it wasn't 15 minutes later, we're on the river and I have my fly rod and one of them hits. And it's exactly what you just described. This fish is going down river. It takes the line into my backing. But before it even got there, as soon as Terry saw that I had a fish, he immediately, not me, but he said, oh, thank you, Lord, that Robbie's got this fish. And it triggered me to go, oh, yeah, I forgot what my... That was what I really wanted to experience, was I wanted to experience catching that fish with you. And I was able to, And literally that fight on that fish with that fly rod probably took 45 minutes.
Wow. That's pretty amazing stuff, but I'm not to the point where when the fish hits, I don't think I can. I can't tell you exactly what all goes through my mind, but
well, I still am trying.
The Lord's Prayer, I'm not sure is at the top of it, but I want to get there.
And I'm there, you know, every time I go fishing now, or if I go hunting, same thing. When I went dove hunting, I was like, okay, we're going to do this. And here's the way, the best way to help is like, tell your wife, whoever you got with you, say, please, man, if I can, you know, trigger me, tell me, start praying, you know, so that I can experience it.
Like your buddy did.
Right, yeah. Right. Because, I mean, we don't, you know, I know that feeling, man. And I'm like, okay. So what's your story? Come on, we triggered something in you, and we want to hear it. 866-348-7884, 866-34-TRUTH. So again, as always, we want to mention the Jesus Labor Love, which is car repair labor for single moms, widows, and families in crisis. And not only do we do that, but if you know somebody who has a car, right, that they... you know, it's not worth enough to check trade in or whatever. And they just, you know, we're going to give it away. Well, hey, the Jesus Labor Love could use it. You know, I got a text this week from a poor lady who's been on the waiting list for a long, long time. And she's checking in to see if I've gotten any cars. And, you know, boy, would I love the joy, right? It would be amazing to be able to tell her, oh, good news. I got one.
I got one.
And so, again, it's all there at ChristianCarGuy.com, at ChristianCarGuy.com. All sorts of information, including some notes on the show today, Aristotle's quote and that kind of stuff. But, again, the Jesus Labor Love, if you want to donate a car, you want to donate prayer, whatever it is that you've got that you want to help out with single moms and widows and families in crisis, we want to remind you of that. But also... as I was thinking about this idea, it was fascinating to me that this very week, I had an instance with my Toyota where not only was the check engine light on, have you ever had this happen, Bob, where like the car started to miss really badly.
Went in shutdown mode.
And it didn't go into shutdown mode, but the light started flashing. It wasn't just on, but it was like... will, you know, and like, you've got big problems, which was true. I did. One of the coils in my Toyota had failed. But one of the ways that I knew that I had big problems was not only the check engine light on, but the check engine light was flashing.
Pay attention now.
Right. And so, being the cheapskate that I am, right, I didn't immediately... call, you know, somebody to come help out. What I did was I pulled into my local, actually it was an O'Reilly's where a good friend of mine works, and I said, man, will you read the codes on this thing, because the check engine light is literally flashing. And I said, I'm going to bet it's probably a coil. That's what it seems to be every time it does something like that. And he said, oh, yep, misfire on number one. And so I was like, well, just get me a coil, because I know that's where we're headed. And it was. And so I'm back, like my car's running great. But how helpful is it, right? That not only is the check engine light come on, but when it's really, right, it's like getting your attention to tell you, because you could really hurt the car if you drive it along, you know, with that engine misfiring for a long time.
I just want to stop right now. I know this is totally off base, but I just feel really, I need to say this. Just want to love on Jerry Mathis and Dale, Julie, the whole family, and Gina and everybody. They lost their father, the patriarch of Ray's Body Shop and Record Service, passed recently, and I was out of town and didn't get by, and I'll be by, but... just some of the greatest people in the world, the whole family, and we just love on them. And I just wanted everybody to keep the whole family in your thoughts and prayers, because they are just, when you mentioned you was on the side of the road or are about to be on the side of the road, it just rang my bell to mention them.
Yeah, and actually Jerry was on the show last week and shared a very touching story about how, you know, he had a chance to share Christ with his dad. You know, really moments or I guess within the last few days of, and then again in the last moments of his life, we're pretty blessed as Jerry shared that. And you know, it was, it's tough, but I'm so glad you mentioned it, Bob, because you know, just very, very dear to this show, and you know, one of our closest friends, you know, and by all means, you know, it was their dad. And it's a different thing when you lose your dad. You know that. I was there.
You were there, yeah.
And you were there when I lost mine. And so it's a hard thing. So, yeah, I'm so glad about that. So, hey, we got one more segment for you to call and tell us. When your check engine light came on, 866-348-7884, 866-34-TRUTH. Call us.
You're listening to the Truth Network and TruthNetwork.com.
You will learn to savor words and language.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. And love all of mankind as you would love yourself. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul and mind, and love all mankind.
Well, it's 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55.
Aristotle's check engine light today on the Christian Car Guys Show. And but the idea of that being, right, the totality is not, as it were, a mere heap, but the whole is something besides the parts. And so we had talked about that today's show is brought to you by the letter Aleph. And so Aleph includes all of us in its own way. I'll get into that in a second. But that means you who need to call us at 866-348-7884 because you have a story about your check engine light. We want to hear it. About when you needed to check in with God, 866-348-7884. So as we talked about, that the Aleph begins the word father, it begins the word mother, it begins the word brother, and it begins the word sister, but it also, more importantly, begins the word Abba, which is father, and it begins the word Adonai, which is very much related to Father God. And so when you look at the beginning of the Shema, we've talked about this in several shows, but I want to take some parts for you to show you how cool this all kind of comes together. So the very first line in that prayer in Deuteronomy 6:4 is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God. The Lord is one, right? And that word one means a lot of things, but I just want to let you in on some of the parts, okay? Because as we talked about, you know, it's what the sum of the parts make up something different than just the parts. But just to break it down for a minute, the word is in Hebrew, ahad. You hear what it begins with, Bob? Ah, it begins with an A. It begins with an aleph for very good reason, right? And actually, if you take the first two letters of ahad, you have brother. And brother is, when you take those parts, it's a very unique bond. It's a beautiful thing. Like brothers share a language. Like my brother and I, when we get together, we can talk about somebody going Bob Dylmer on somebody, and we know exactly what that means that, you know, other people outside of our family may not know. But you have a language. You have a connection with your brother that is a connection that, you know, it's very, very, very deep. And the idea is, in some ways, that Jesus is your older brother. You're right, because God is your father, then who is your brother? Oh. And the fact that you're one with all them is ahad, right? But the fascinating thing about the word ahad is it begins with the idea of brother. And see, so this idea of brother, and then it ends in the same letter that ends the word, or that is in the middle of the word Adam, that you hear that D sound. Well, ahad ends with that D sound. And it's very connected to the whole idea of all mankind needing to love the Lord their God with all their heart, with all their soul, and with all their
might.
Miod, which also ends with that D sound. You hear it? Miod. And so like ahad ends with a D, It just would point out that that's what my name begins with, Dillmore. Just kidding. But anyway, that D sound at the end of both of them is telling you something. It's telling you that in order to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your strength, and with all your miod, you have to be in the family. Okay? You have to be one. Right? Hear, O Israel, you God wrestlers, right? The Lord, your God, the Lord is your brother. Well, in order for him to be your brother, you have to have received the blood, okay? Which begins with that same letter. In Hebrew, it's dam, okay? It's a dalet and a mem. Similar letters to the word Adam, okay? Okay, all these parts are making up something, and they're telling you something. They're telling you that you need to be in the blood in order to be a brother. And once you have that, then you'll have the ability to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your all. Get the picture? Because once you have that, then you could have brothers and sisters. So this week is my birthday. I love it. And so Mark 10:30, my birthday is on 10:30. And Mark 10:30 is my verse because, you know, it has my birthday in it. And it says that those of you, right, who lose lands, mothers, fathers, sisters, and brothers for my sake and the sake of the gospel will not fail to receive 100 mothers, sisters, brothers, and lands, and, oh, by the way, persecutions for my sake and the sake of the gospel in this present age and in the age to come, eternal life. What I'm saying is I have 100 mothers because I'm a brother. I have 100 sisters, and I have 100. I have way more, okay? I have way more than 100 mothers. I have way more than 100 brothers. It's amazing when you start to put the pencil to how many real mothers, how many sisters, how many brothers, because why? Because Jesus's blood, which all has to do with those two things. Now, the reason why I go over this again is that the Jews are told to pray this prayer. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your all. They're told to pray that the first thing before their feet hit the ground. They're told to pray it, a sign that got that prayer on the door when they go out of their house, when they come into their house. They're also supposed to talk about it all day long. And then when they put their head on the pillow at night, what are they supposed to pray? That prayer. Why?
It's essential.
Because if you don't have that in your heart, your check engine light is going off. It's saying, man, you need this information. You need to understand that guy you're so mad at that just cut you off in traffic, he's your brother, right? That person that lives down the street from you, or that person that's beside the road broke down that you need to be not, you know, forgetting about. Now, he may not be your brother yet, but the only chance he's got at being your brother is if somebody tells him that he's got a potential to be your brother, right? And the idea of that whole ahad is that, hey, what are we doing here? My brother is down on the side of the road. If he doesn't know Jesus, whether he knows it or not, he's down on the side of the road, and he is missing out on life and life abundant. And so, man, I need to be praying for him. I need to be doing what I can do to help him, no matter the condition, right? This was the picture of what God had in mind, that we pray the first thing we get up and the first, last thing before we go to bed at night, Paul.
All the fishing analogies today just kind of touched my heart while ago. I was taking a moment to think and, you know, about how I sniffed the bait a little bit and then I nibbled the bait a little bit. And then I grabbed the hook and I ran with it. And I just wondering if God was really excited as the line was peeling off and then he started to reel me back in and all that, you know, the fishing stuff got to me today. I want to thank you for letting me be a part of this. And it just really brought things because, you know, some of the things that I have the most clarity is when I can relate it to my life. And that for me, I feel like I hope God was excited as I slowed down.
I'm going to bet he was more excited than you were when you caught that drum last week.
Well, it's just an amazing thing. The trip, the journey we've been on together with, Ray and Jerry and the family and you and just the group I've become a part of. It just really, really, really touches my heart to be a part of all this. And, thank you for having me here today.
Oh, Bob, as always, you are a brother and you know that. And there's nothing like, getting together when we do and getting together with you. Because if you're listening, my guess is you're a brother or you're a sister. And thank you for getting together with us. Remember, slow down. Jesus walked everywhere he went, got it all done in 33 years. Thanks again.
This is the Truth Network.